Yes, ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for joining us for this latest episode of Big Bob's Big Archive. My name's Carl Birmidge, and joining me, as ever, my co-host, Mr. Carl Dutton.
Yo.
And Mr. Joseph Tilly.
Pour me a drink.
And joining us again from his hiatus in university, Mr. Paul Barron.
Hello, Paul.
Hello. It's really good to be back, bringing back the usual, well, stuff that I usually did in the previous podcast.
Well, it brings a new dynamic, because a lot of the shows lately have been me and Carl agreeing, and then Joseph just kind of going, well, okay.
So basically you needed the controversial sort of opinion or something to go in and wedge it in there. So yeah, here we go.
Yeah, and you've chosen a hell of a series to come back to, Paul, because we're going to be talking today about Celebrity Big Brother 4, a series which many people regarded as the best celebrity series of them all.
Let me load up the mockery gun.
Oh, dear.
As I said, Celebrity 4 is very highly regarded on the internet forums with casual audience. I think it's one of the most watched celebrity series that there's been. In a strange way, though, it's also a celebrity series which I resent to an extent. And in my mind, that might find that hard to fathom, but for me, the celebrity franchise of Big Brother, the Celebrity Strand, was always something a little bit extra. It was just filler in a cold January to pass the time. It didn't really even matter if the series was bad. It was just Big Brother for anybody who was desperate enough. This series, for me, was so good that it showed the celebrity branch of the franchise could stand on its own 2 feet. And now it's got to the stage where the celebrity version is arguably more important than the civilian version.
Because it's a grinder of bloody gossip and hot news for the newspaper and tabloids.
Or maybe just an example of how our attitudes toward reality television have changed, and it's more celebrity orientated. But I do.
And it's down to ratings as well. It's down to the fact that, this change wouldn't happen for another 4 years until they went to Channel 5. And the Channel 5 people obviously see that the ratings of the celebrity one are higher, and the regular one are not. So they push the celebrity one more, which is annoying. But it's how they've always. For some reason, it's the way that they've always focused things. And maybe that's just Channel 5 as a broadcast company. Maybe that's just the way that they see things. Maybe it's just seeing it as a business, which you can't really blame them. I don't know whether this one did it, because, of course, the next year's series was the thing that killed the franchise, really, or at least started the downfall. But it was certainly a strong case of some people remember it when they think of the celebrity one.
Yeah. Definitely. But it is a good show, and I'm certainly going to enjoy talking about it, because so much happened in this series, so many big characters, and so many discussion points as well. Place we're going to start, though, is going to have to be launch night. And first of all, our assessment of the cast in general, before we went there, talking about two people in particular who were very controversial casting choices. Your opinions of the cast, and we'll start with Joe first.
For me, it was a great cast. I liked the most of the celebrities, and some I'd never heard of. I'd never heard of Dennis Rodman or Tracy Bingham.
What?
I don't watch basketball. I'm not a basketball fan.
To be fair, I'd only heard of him because of the NWO, so.
Yeah. And Tracy, you know, I kind of recognised when I saw the Baywatch clip, but that's it. But everyone else was great, apart from, you know, Chantel.
That's very interesting, because we have a lot to discuss about Chantel, because, of course, Chantel was the big selling point of this series. What about you, Paul? Did you enjoy this year's cast? Did you think it was a good selection?
It was a good selection because you know, you've got a lot of interesting characters. You've got Barrymore. You've got He Who Shall Be Named, but we all know that he's got lips like a baboon's ass. You've got the surprise twist of a normal person pretending to be a celebrity in a house full of celebrities, and you've got the dullness of Dennis Rodman. But
there was almost something civilian about this celebrity franchise. I could imagine the type of housemates they cast for the celebrity version being in a normal civilian series, that sort of extreme. They pushed the extremeness with the celebrities as much as they could, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Yeah. But as I mentioned, though, there were two big casting controversies which started, and we're going to bring up the first one, and it's quite obviously Paul just mentioned them there, which is the decision to cast Michael Barrymore, because as we remember, Michael Barrymore at that point was still under scrutiny for the whole murder in his swimming pool. And I don't think he'd been acquitted yet. And with our guilty until proven innocent culture in this country, he was, in the eyes of a lot of viewers, a murderer. And yet he was cast here basically with the aim of rebuilding his career. Did you think it was a wise choice? Because obviously Barrymore was going to generate controversy. He was going to be this big star power name that was going to sell the show. So in that regard, it worked. But do you think ethically he should have been there?
Yeah, I do. I honestly think, you know, if you look past, because, you know, you don't know if he did or didn't do this crime. If you just look past that and you see Michael Barrymore and his character, and you know he's a funny guy, and I think it's just great that, you know, you saw Michael the person, not the celebrity.
Yeah, I can agree with you there, because it's Michael Barrymore. I mean, his murder trial is getting more infamous, like the OJ, Simpson trial, but unfortunately, it didn't end in the spectacular, the sort of tragic way that it did. But you know, for the majority of it, I thought he was literally dead. So, yeah, but mind you, this is coming from the same person who basically thought that Chevy Chase was dead for 20 years. Apparently, he wasn't.
Just his career.
Just his career.
What about you, Carl? What was your opinion on Barrymore's casting?
It's down to the same thing as the reason as to why Helen is in the house this year, except times that by 10 because he's an actual celebrity, and also to the fact that everybody in the country knows his name. So you've got this big controversial star, a lightning rod, papers and tabloids are all focused on this guy, and there he is in the house. It's going to get the ratings, it's going to get press, it's everything that the producers want.
So basically, everyone's going, point! Look at him! Look at him! He's done something wrong! Let's all point and stare!
Exactly. And then, you know, the viewers, you know, as they want to do, they like to tear people down and they like to build people up or feel like people have redeemed themselves. And it was really his story, this series, as one of the major storylines was him. You know, he started off as this sort of... Well, he wasn't very liked, and then he started to get softer. By the end, he was one of the favourites to win the show. So,
yeah,
pretty much.
I always found something quite tragic about the concept of Barrymore being in there in the first place. Because I remember when I was a kid, he was on every single Saturday night TV show. It was almost like Manchester United playing in League Two.
Yeah, and there was just something so kind of shell shocked about his whole expression for the entire thing. He just looked like he was not. Like, everything he'd been before was like a facade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other big controversial casting is the next thing we're going to come on to. And it's something which I don't think we would have fully understood back when we watched it in the first series when we were all like 14, 15-year-old kids. But it was a big controversy, and that was George Galloway being cast, despite being a sitting member of Parliament.
I think I like that casting because, you know... I actually did know back then who George was because my mum's she's into politics and stuff. So I knew what he was about and I knew he was like an outspoken person. I like that. I think he was brilliant in the house.
Don't get me wrong, George served his purpose in the house. He's a good casting. And I don't agree with him as a person, but as a housemate, he was certainly great value. I think the point was that he'd been voted in by his constituents with the aim of doing a job for them. And instead, he's gallivanting off, getting airtime for himself, pretending to be a cat. I think that's what didn't sit well with people.
That shows both Labour, because we want kittens and puppies in next year, don't we?
It was him trying to, you know, he said he was like, I was trying to appeal to the younger demographic. This is what the younger demographic like. So I'm going to use this as a chance to appeal to my younger audience, things like that. And it completely and utterly backfired, destroyed his political career, meaning that no other policy. I'm getting a lot of echo for somebody.
Try now.
Okay, there we go. No, it made sure that no other politician would ever go in again, pretty much.
Tommy Sheridan.
True. Maybe they didn't learn their lesson.
Michael Madsen.
The Ministry of Baltimore. I think he made a good point there about the perception of politicians, because I'd actually make the argument what Galloway did was show politicians can work on a show like this. Because he was the first one to do it, and we've seen a lot more, not only on Big Brother, but I'm a Celebrity, we've seen Nadine Dorris do it. I think he's made politics a lot more open to reality television.
Yeah. And he also gave this feeling when you watch kind of his eviction, you saw the Newsnight guy and all that stuff, like, you had the feeling of how big Big Brother was back then.
Yes.
He certainly added to that.
I think I'm right in saying that Galloway's eviction was actually reported on Newsnight.
Yeah.
That's how big it was.
Yeah, but you know what he's get, you know what the main presenter of Newsnight's going to be like. He's basically, you know, basically loading up a gun of opinions, and then suddenly, do you think you were proven as insane and immature? Boom! Out of the door.
Yeah, the whole thing message was like, do you think you should have gotten that, you know, unitard and cat noises and yeah.
Yeah.
And we're going to have so much fun talking about them. Last part of launch time, which we need to bring up with, is the whole novelty of this year's, of the original first few days, and the novelty of the entire series, and that was Chantel's casting and her task to try and make herself a non-celebrity, showcase herself as a celebrity. Of course, Chantel's facade was that she was a member of a girl group called Candy Floss, with a K.
With a K.
Because bad spelling is cool.
And I think the song was I Want It Right Now.
Yeah.
Yes. And I did just get the Nostalgia Critic reference, by the way.
Thank you.
To me, I think that it was funny because the majority of the others were like older people. So the fact that they didn't know who it was like, yeah, I just don't know who this band is. I've never heard of them. It worked. And then for the others, they were just like, oh, I suppose it's just some band I've not heard of, you know?
Yeah.
Like Bewitched.
Yeah.
I did think Maggot was going to fess her up, like, because Maggot's in the music industry. I thought he was going to be like, no, they don't exist.
But mind you, honest opinion, who here knows about Goldie Looking Chain?
They were quite big back in 2005.
Shame, never mind.
Does anybody know how she got cast?
I believe...
Did she get cast, or did she go through the system, like...
The story was she was one of the backups for Big Brother 6.
Okay.
Right. I think it was between Chantel and Saskia over who would make the final
cut. They must have thought there'd be something about her that would work perfectly for this role, for being the only civilian to go in there.
Yes.
I guess they just saw her appearance and was like, wow, she looks like a Barbie doll. What? So, you know, there we go, it works.
Am I right in saying she worked a bit as a Paris Hilton lookalike?
Probably.
I think she called herself Paris Travel Lodge.
Oh. It's... Oh, that's just... No.
Awesome.
Oh. Bad.
No, that's genuine. She genuinely...
No, that's good. That's self-defacing.
Yeah. and I think she was perfect for the role, though, because she had this... There was an innocence about Chantel and a naivety. She worked perfectly for the role. And I think what you need, if you're going to do a whole twist, a series-long twist surrounding someone, you need to make sure that the person who's benefiting from it is relatable and likable to the audience. And I think Chantel served that. I mean, if you compare it to Helen in this year's series, who basically had a twist revolving around her, but doesn't have the wall to make it work.
No, it makes her as kind of the protagonist going, it's like, the here's our normal girl like us who's going into this crazy world of celebrities and she has to survive the sharks. It kind of makes her rootable. Well, yeah.
And I do think, I'm not the biggest lover of twists, especially ones which seem very contrived, but I think this one worked. I think this was because it still had a theoretical side to it. It was looking at, as you mentioned before, Carl, it was looking at the concept of celebrity in general and saying that, yes, you can have that status of being an A-lister or a Z-lister, but it's about the person. It nullified the celebrity aspect of Big Brother.
Yeah, it was more about, you know, once you're in that house, it's about who you are as a person. And at the end of the day, most of the people in there probably haven't heard of each other just because, you know, they're from different industries or whatever. So it's more about that. And I think For me, it was a hook. I enjoy twists when they're done well. When they're overdone and they're silly and they're just, you can tell they're just trying to save somebody, that's like, it's ugh. But when it's like something like this, that it's genuine, like, I need to see tomorrow to see what's going to go on with this, then I'm interested.
Yes, definitely. If there was one thing, though, that I don't agree with, though, is that it made Chantel, in my opinion, unstoppable. I knew the moment that she survived in the house, if it didn't, so she was a non-celebrity, she had the series wrapped up.
Well, just because the chaps would all vote for her because she's one of them.
One of them.
Well, not really, because she had the whole novelty of being a non-celebrity and celebrity Big Brother.
I'm sure that's a big part of it. But I'd say there was other contenders at that point. It depends on what could have happened. I mean, she could have ended up being a big bitch, for all we knew at that point.
Maybe, yeah. Now, we're going to be moving on to the first week. We've got all of our 11 housemates in. And the first note I've got on my list is the showcase your talent task. With a basic icebreaker, nice and fun. Tracy Bingham in a red swimsuit. No one's ever popped for that.
That was for stiffing all the housemates in the car, but there you go.
I think that was Celebrity 7.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it was an icebreaker task, but it was a bit of fun. But there were two notes which I had, which was Chantel very nearly messing up right at the first opportunity because she has to sing her song, sing I Want It Right Now. And the fact that she's tone deaf, not so many girls remember, to be honest.
No.
And actually has to read the lyrics from a sheet because she doesn't know them.
If I was in the house, I would just be like, oh my God, Simon Cowell, he's just got worse.
Simon Cowell will probably be sitting at home and going, Jesus Christ, what kind of crap did they put on this TV show anyway?
Oh, I'm surprised, honestly, that one of those types did try and hire her out the house to try and have her do an actual music career.
I think he did. Yeah.
Did they?
I'll try and YouTube it, but I think he actually genuinely did release I Want It Right Now.
Oh dear.
He must be having a shudder down his
lots head. Of auto-tuning.
Yeah. Lots of it. So of course along with that we also had Pete singing "You Spin Me Round Like a Record." Dennis Rodman did a bit of basketball. Jordy Marsh gave a speech.
Okay, because that's what she's known for.
Yes,
she's got a bap, so there you go.
The claim to fame is basically being a rake with two melons strapped to it. So there we go. A speech.
Yeah. Well, now at least nowadays she could lift weights or something.
Yes. She become a bodybuilder. And the other one which got a lot of interest about it about that task was again Michael Barrymore, where he did a comedy routine and in typical comedy style, when your back's against the wall and you want to try and prove yourself funny, he resorts to Hitler impressions.
Yeah.
He was from a different generation and, you know, what the hell? Politically correct humour.
Could you imagine, though, if that task had been done today and Barrymore did his impression?
Would have been calling for him to be thrown out of the house. Jeez.
A lot of people in Germany during that time would probably say, get the hell out. I mean,
yeah, but the same joke was done on Fawlty Towers, and granted that was in the 70s, but...
Oh, and it's hilarious.
Yeah, exactly. It's like when I do a Chris Benoit joke. It's taking the piss out of someone.
Yeah. But yeah, that was a bit of a slip-up from Barrymore, and you could tell the reactions from the rest of the housemates. They were all a bit suspect about that. You were all like, should we really be laughing at this?
Yeah.
And there was this real... I'm trying to think of the right word here. Barrymore in those early stages was very fraught. I didn't enjoy watching Michael in those early stages because he seemed very fragile.
Shell-shocked.
Yes. There was almost this feeling watching him of him thinking to himself, has my life really come to this?
Well, let's think about this. You've basically been accused of murder. You've been silent for about 6 years and you've been popped onto a reality TV show with people who have basically fallen into the pit of obscurity. And then there's Dennis Rodman.
I'm actually going to defend Dennis's celebrity because I think he was quite a big name. I was quite taken aback when he got Dennis Rodman. Because, I mean, he was notorious.
Aye.
Especially in America. But we are going to move on, though, and we're coming to that whole point of star power, which is the ranking yourself in order of fame. Of course, we knew that the task was, if Chantel finished in last place, she would be the one that ended up going. They'd expose her as a non-celebrity and just kick her out there. And what I loved about it was all the arguments that went on about fame. It really showed up a lot of people and how desperate they were to be seen as famous, but also some of the other reactions, because I remember when they got told the task, they all had to decide between each other. And there was this big argument over whether or not Michael should be number one. Some argued Dennis because he was more popular in America. And whilst all this is going on, Maggie just walks straight over to number 11.
Yeah.
You just like, ignore me, I'm just going straight here. I'm not even going to argue.
The Welsh rapper, I'm just going to go. There we go. I'm happy here.
But I really did think it was funny. And I've actually got the list here. Michael was the number one choice. And I think Dennis, Pete and George followed just behind.
And let's just say, no matter what you think, I think that's ridiculous. Dennis Rodman is obviously the most famous person in the house.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It was Galloway, wasn't he? He was like, no, Michael is the most famous. Yeah. All right, George.
Well, George argued that he should have been most famous because 1.3 billion Muslims knew who he was.
Oh, okay.
But I found that whole task quite funny, especially just Maggots just reacting to just, I'm not even bothered, I'm the least famous.
But, you know, Dennis Rodman's not as famous as Paramount. He's the only reason why North Korea have a nobody US yet. We're going to kill everyone but Dennis Rodman. We like him.
So there you go, proof. Dennis Rodman serves a purpose in life.
Ding!
But yeah, a fun task, and of course Chantel saves herself and inevitably goes on to win from that point. Now, we're going to move on to something else. Now, this was something which caused a lot of controversy, and it also is something which I want to bring up in regard to how people perceive the show today, and that was Jodie Marsh's treatment from the rest of the house.
Yeah.
And in particular, Michael Barrymore's attack on it, where Barrymore was basically accusing Jodie. I believe Jodie was befriending Chantel, and Michael made the suggestion that Jodie was only doing that because of the cameras, because of the airtime. And goes on this big show and tell, saying, oh, you got that camera folks on you, you got that camera, na 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 na. And that was the lowest that Barrymore got, because I think some people were maybe open to trying and accepting Michael and seeing a bit of a redemption in him. That really put a lot of people off him to an extent that I don't think he was ever going to win from that point.
Yeah,
maybe there was other stuff that we didn't see, you know, in the live feeds or whatever as we watch it back now. But from everything that we saw, Jodie was doing nothing but trying to get along with everybody. No matter what you think of the girl, she was being nice to everybody. She was getting on. And then Michael just went straight for her. He had this thing out for her for some reason. And he was pretty much the villain of that early portion just because of how he was treating her. And then for some reason, she was voted out because apparently the public agree. So,
and that's the next point I want to bring on to, which is that in this day and age, if someone is seen as the victim in a way that Jodie was, I mean, it wasn't just Michael. Pete did it to an extent. George did it to an extent.
Pete did out of boredom, though.
Yeah, it does make it right, though. But the whole point was, though, that he is this victim. Now, in the normal day and age, if you're the victim on Big Brother, you're a lot to get to the end. People love you for that. And yet, Jodie was the first person out. It really shows to me how the audience's interpretation has changed in that maybe where we don't just buy into this whole victim culture.
Well, it's not a case of her just being a victim. She really was mistreated, and it would have us as the audience would have at this day and age, the way that we think, we would have loved to have socked it to the other group by keeping her, and that's, you know, just let's see their reactions when she's kept. And I honestly was hoping she was, because I never watched this series when it was on, which is bizarre because I was probably one of the most only people, because at the time when this was on, I only watched the main series. I wasn't really into the celebrity one, which is kind of the opposite of some people.
T-Mobile.
I went back and watched it a couple of years ago, and at this point, I was hoping that she wouldn't go, and then she did, and I was like, ugh.
Why do you think she did go though?
Maybe it's just, again, maybe it's because there was a larger audience back then, and back then the other people who were ganging up on her had more fans.
Really, Pete Burns and George Galloway?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. Maybe, again, it's just the fact that there's so many girls watching the show, and it's basically a model, so get her out of there.
That's what I was thinking. Do you think maybe the pre-show stuff was one of the detriments to Georgie? Because she came into Celebrity Big Brother at a time when Katie Price was probably at a peak of her popularity, and of course, Geordie Marsh was the big villain to watch Georgie Price.
Basically, my tits bigger than your tits. My tits bigger than all your tits. Sorry. I couldn't help it.
So, but of course, the villain of the super popular Katie Price isn't going to win over the audience.
Yeah.
Because Katie just done I'm a Celebrity as well.
And she got slated
twice
every several minutes for it.
Well, the first time around, she was popular.
Well, yeah. Every time.
Yeah.
Every time she got a task. God.
Oh, hey, can I just say, before we move on to that, can I say the rest of the task, the scientific tasks,
oh, fantastic. Yes, we're coming on to this. We're coming on to the science task right now.
Science!
Which, of course, they don't do a lot of these anymore, though. And this was the experiment task. It was basically the group was split into several different mini sections, all under the theme of experimentation. So, Barrymore's was, can you make yourself lucky? Which basically involved him smashing eggs against his head. Joe, can you tell me any of the others? Apart from the obvious one?
There was, can eating a box of a liqueur chocolates send you over the drink drive limit? Can you learn Japanese in your sleep? Does talking to plants make them grow? can humans communicate with animals?
Oh, boy.
Yeah. And of course, the most famous words, would you like me to be the cat?
Mind you, ironically, that sounds like all the stuff that I would have probably done in one fell swoop in 1 hour. I mean, you've got the experiment of, will chocolate liqueurs make you more drunk? The answer is no, but apparently a couple of pints of Brewdog would do that very quickly.
And also apparently it'll make you incredibly sick, because
yes,
he struggled with that. I don't know why he struggled with that. It's chocolate, but whatever.
Chocolate and alcohol, it's any man's dream.
Yeah, yeah. He's a thin person, maybe he can fit it all in.
Someday there will be ale chocolates out there. There will be ales.
But of course, the one point thing we need to talk about, though, George Galloway's cat impression.
He was all in, wasn't he? That was the thing with him. From the moment he started getting tasks, he was like, we have got to try. I've got to make sure that I am fully committed to these. And it's like, he took them so seriously and was so into them. Yeah, and this was the feature part of it. Who was the woman again?
It was Rula Lenska.
Okay, yeah. Those two had this kind of weird thing, and that it revolted
in
that.
It was like a little romance.
Yeah, I think people saw it as kind of...
Yeah, but every single person in the Labour Party is going, no! No, you tits! You fucking moron!
But he was Liberal, wasn't he?
I think by that point he was an independent MP.
Oh, was he? Okay.
I think he left the Labour Party because of the Iraq War.
Okay, okay.
You mentioned there that George took every task seriously. And I would make, and you would think, though, that that would be something which would endear him to the audience. You'd think, hey, he is this politician. He doesn't take himself too seriously. He's trying hard. That's a good trait.
It was just so cringy. It was like watching two older people having a sex game. That was what it was. It's what it looked like. It looked like they were having role play.
And
pensioner role play. That's something I'm going to need to have a vodka for.
And I remember as well, because this is back when my mum and dad still watched the show. They didn't watch it anymore. And I just remember seeing them turning around when this whole thing was happening, and the look of horror on their faces was just...
That was not just two people. The entirety of Britain had that same look of horror on their faces.
And this wasn't what kicked him out, though.
Oh, no.
I'm guessing something worse.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean... that's one of those infamous Big Brother moments now. That's like one of those, everybody talks about that series when they talk about great Celebrity Big Brother moments. But and the scary thing as well was Rula's reaction to it. And what made it worse, like, yes, George was being a cat, he was purring. It was Ruler going, oh, that's a nice pussy cat. You got some milk on your whiskers.
When I say that George Galloway now is a pussy.
Yeah,
my room goes dead.
Yeah, of course, infamous task. Everybody remembers it, and of course, it gives us a laugh now. But I can imagine the reaction then just being hideous. But of course, we come to the first eviction, and it's Jodie Marsh. I think am I right in saying Jodie was nominated by every other housemate that week?
Yeah,
I think so. I'll have to double check. But it was Jodie
versus
Pete versus George. And of course, it's Jodie who ends up going, which surprisingly, I mean, Pete and George are some of the most antagonistic figures of the celebrity franchise's history. And they end up surviving an eviction against Jodie Marsh, which is just ironic.
Yeah, I mean, these days, definitely one of them would have gone. Maybe at the time, it was just the fact that those two were just such big characters. And it was them or her, and she wasn't really bringing as much to the show. And I can't imagine that the casual fans at that point were thinking it that way, but I'm sure it was just, moo, hiss, big tits, get her out.
We think she's brainless and, you know, she has no feelings because she has big, massive melons. She is a stick with melons on them. Out.
But it brings me on to the question, what was your opinion of Jodie, the housemate? Because she wasn't a bad person, really.
No.
She's a nice girl who got picked on and the public got her out because of her appearance and her past.
Basically, everyone see this banner, get underneath it, she's gone.
And I do think it's a real shame, though, because I don't think she warranted being the first, but I think it was the right decision in retrospect, definitely. But, because, and I'll also make the argument as well, that this may be an extreme connection, but Jodie Marsh had really been on the wane as a personality back then, anyway. She really lived on the back of being Katie Price's enemy. This was really the last chance she really had to try and make herself as a celebrity. And you can make the argument that her failure here basically pushed her out the limelight and led to her career now.
As a bodybuilder.
Yeah, but I mean, she's happy doing it. She's got herself together.
Yeah, but, you know, I had a lecture with someone named Francesca Steele.
Yeah.
And she was an artist who took up bodybuilding. And it takes everything out of you.
Yeah.
It does really just take everything out of you.
But then I would commend Jodie Marsh for having the enthusiasm to keep that sort of career going.
Aye.
And I think she was very partially treated on the show, though, and I found it very surprising the way in which the public didn't side with her in a situation where, in this day and age, she would do. Yeah. We're going to move on, though, and we're coming to something now which I'm feeling very uncomfortable about. And
Hold on. Before you start, I've got a little bit of ambiance music for us.
Oh, Joe, turn that off. Joe.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, this is the section where we talk about Jimmy Savile's visit.
Ooh,
now,
God.
I've seen a lot of uncomfortable stuff on Big Brother. I've seen the racist bullying of Shetty. I've seen a woman masturbating on a wine bottle. In retrospect, though, this is the most uncomfortable Big Brother moment of them all. The fact that Britain's most notorious sex offender was in the Big Brother house and having his behaviour, I know nobody knew about it then, but having him as a person celebrated, it's very uncomfortable viewing.
Yeah, luckily, when I watched this, it was before everything had happened. The guy, at the end of the day, we didn't know then what we do know now, the end. You know,
yeah. What you'll find though in a lot of cases is when you watch clips of any sort of Savile show now, you find yourself looking for any sort of clue in the things he says or the things he does to try and say, how do we miss that? There's a clue there. And even then, there's moments in the house where you can sort of see that because, where he says hello to everyone, he's shaking their hands and hugging everybody when he comes in. And when he hugs Chantel, the hug's just a little bit too frivolous and a little bit too long, and you're just like, God, get away from her!
Get away from her, you creepy uncle!
It's
Yeah, well, she was over 18, so...
Yeah. But it's still very uneasy, and I mean, when he's talking about the prison system, when you know that's where he should have gone to, it's very uneasy viewing. And And there's a scene right at the end as well, after he leaves. I think Pete's talking to George Galloway. And Pete says something along the lines of, he's got a lot of secrets he's going to take with him to the grave. And that's dodgy enough. But when you think of the type of person Pete is, it just makes it even worse.
Yeah. Wow.
Mr. You know, spin me right round with... I'm not going to go into it.
Yes. At the time, though, we'll focus on it at the time. What was your opinion on that visit?
I just think it was a bit of fun. Yeah, it's just another fun task. One that they haven't endlessly recycled, actually.
It was something where this is somebody they probably wanted to go in the house, but he was too old or whatever, yeah, and he didn't want to. So they put him in there as kind of a special guest, the same way as they did a couple of years ago with what's-her-face, Baywatch girl.
Pamela Anderson.
There we go. Couldn't think of the name. Yeah. So, okay, same kind of thing as that. And it's just the fact that we now know what we know that's made it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think Pam's too old.
Well, no, but she was too big, too famous.
And yeah.
She would try and do the, I know I'm going to get told off for this, but have you ever heard of Show What You Wanted?
I don't think anybody can ever listen to Shawaddy Waddy now because of that.
Let's just say I was playing Cards Against Humanity the other day, and one of the answers was Jim will fix it.
Oh,
I said. So.
And yes, the question was, what ruined the school trip?
Oh!
I won that game.
Oh, that's
hilarious. I salute you. Oh, God.
You win the internet today.
Yeah, you win the internet for today.
Bring the crown and throne.
Yeah. So, of course, Savile's visit comes to an end. We didn't know then, obviously, what we know now. But from one moment to another, and this was one which... A bit underwhelming considering the skill that I had to live up to. We saw a redux of the box task.
Yeah, this is one that's like, they keep redoing the fucking bedsit. To the point I want them to blow up the side of the fucking house. Just the task room, just go. But, right, this is one that I actually want to see again, because it was brilliant. And it was so much fun out of just nothing. It cost no production, it cost no budget, and it just makes so much entertainment to television. And the bit where they're cutting between the face and the boxes as they're talking, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Well, the great thing about that, though, as well, was that what they did for Celebrity 6, which makes it better, is they used outtakes of the profile pictures for the side of the box. But yeah, all of them were all quite comedic. So, like, it cuts to Preston, and he's doing, like, this... And it cuts to Preston talking, but he's doing, like, this really, like, comedic face where, like, it's basically eating itself. And Michael's doing, like, a what-the-hell face and...
Yeah.
it makes it funnier for me, but
it was a brilliant task and I wish they'd do it again.
This one though was maybe a little bit disappointing though, because what we found very early on was all of them agreeing to say, let's just let Lula win.
It took a little while, it took them like an hour maybe.
Yeah, but the Big Brother 6 one lasted 3 days, so.
Well, because they weren't willing to put up with the same crap as the cast as the civilians from the streets were.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think any of them, I think they were all tired and didn't want to do it. So, I don't know.
But that was a shame, though, because obviously production would have wanted to do the box task again because it was so brilliant the first time. It just made me a little bit disappointing the second time. There were still some funny moments, but not the last-minute epic that everybody wanted.
Mind you, though, at least it didn't...
I know, I liked Pete shouting at them all. That was funny.
Pete Burns shouting any time is just hilarious.
So basically, it's sort of like having that sort of same sort of feeling when you hear a Scottish person sort of shout. You can't help but laugh, but you know you're going to laugh anyway.
One question I would ask, though, is that the prize that Ruler got for this was the Pants of Power.
Yeah.
And which, of course, she was allowed to automatically nominate a housemate, in which case she chose Pete. Am I the only one who thinks, though, that they would have chosen something a little bit better for them had they have tried harder in the task? I just think that's maybe like a stuff you reward.
I don't know. I think it was, I think the fact that it was, you know, the Pants of Power made something that was quite serious, quite silly, which the show is known to do sometimes. But, you know, it was a big enough power. It was kind of like the veto or something.
But mind you, at least they didn't go with, I did a big brother task and all I got was a stupid t-shirt.
Although when Glenn did that 12-hour endurance task, he did just get a tiny little trophy. We're going to be moving on, and as we've already mentioned, Chantel's storyline, the whole Chantel's basically got the series locked, and she basically confirms that win when she gets into a relationship with Preston.
Doesn't really happen in the house. What was weird about, because I'd obviously seen the Ultimate series and things like that before I went back and watched this series in full. What was weird about it was I was thinking it was this full-on romance in the house. It wasn't. He had a girlfriend. It never really happened in the house. They were just friends in the house, and then they got together afterwards, basically because people liked them and wanted them to get together as a couple.
Yeah, and as someone who never really particularly likes showmances, this is one of the few which I really warmed to. And I don't know if it was because Preston was a nice bloke.
Nothing really happened.
Yes, and I think so as well. One thing I did find quite interesting though was that we've seen this sort of thing happen with people in Big Brother, in the civilian version and celebrity version, where they get into relationships, even though they have someone outside, and there's this massive backlash against them. That never really happened with Preston.
Yeah, it was almost the opposite. People were like, no, fuck your girlfriend, get with Chantel. Like that was the entire thing for the series. And it was the same way when it went back in again. They did the exact same thing to another girlfriend. It was like complete hypocrisy. It's like, if we don't like you, then no, you're a bad person for cheating. But if we like the couple, screw them. Get with that person.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay.
There's the small majority of, what about the Audrey boys? What about them? Life will be the death of me and all that.
To be fair, I think people at that point were just thinking, who the hell are the Audrey boys? I tell you what, people criticise the celebrity casting, people criticise the likes of Bobby Sable. Nobody ever has a go at Preston for who the hell he was.
Yeah.
Wasn't he in a band?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, at least that's something. Rather than just standing there in front of a camera, but
just basically him waving it all the time.
Yeah.
I've got my own show.
Do you have any opinions of the Chantel and Preston relationship, Joe?
Well, as I've always said about showmances, I just think they're really tacky and horrible. Tacky in a weird way.
And was this the same?
Yeah, really. I thought it was a bit sickly that I knew nothing was going to happen outside the house. I know it was going to be, you know, oh, we're out of the house now, I don't like you, goodbye. And then it was.
They got married first. But
yeah, they got married. So that was like, you know, it's a waste of money for them, really.
I think with most times with relationships and showmances on the show, there is a real cynicism of, let's get together until the money runs out. I really do think Chantel and Preston did try and make it work.
I think Chantel tried to make it work.
Yeah.
I think Preston was, I think he Preston, did it. He did it.
As you said, boys will be boys, and he's obviously, you know, can't keep his, you know what, in his pants.
Well, I think he was almost pressured by the love for the, you know, and the money and the fame and all that he could get from. I mean, I liked him in the house, don't get me wrong, he was a nice guy, but I'm just, and he is in general a nice guy, but I'm saying, if you were being pressured to say, you know, everybody in the world, in the country was telling you to get with this girl, and if you do get with this girl, then you can make a lot of money out of it and get a lot of profile. He got with it, and then from all accounts, what happened was he realised that he didn't really like her that much in that way, and it was too late to back out because they'd already got married, and then all that happened. But you know,
having sex with a dumb girl and getting a lot of money for it.
Yeah, I mean, to me, I think I liked them in the house. I thought they were a nice pairing. And they really were the two only people in there, other than, you know, there was a couple of others, but they're the only two in there who were just like nice and likable majority of the time and just getting on with it. Whereas the rest of them all would have these moments of being like, oh, I hate this, I want to go.
Do you think Chantel and Preston would be as popular now?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, I do. I agree.
Because the British public haven't got any more brain. I mean, at the end of the day, I almost said it, brain cells. But yeah, at the end of the day, they're going to be fooled by the production and that kind of thing, and that's just how the show has always been. But
just waiting for your obligatory little post-it sign going, vote him out.
Yeah, but I liked these two, and I think we would have liked them anyway because they were two nice people who got along, and they seemed to work well as a pairing. So it's going to work.
There was a relatability about them in a way that there wasn't there with any of the other housemates.
Yeah,
because I mean,
we didn't know who they were.
But Michael was tainted. George was a politician. You can't really like them.
Pete
wasn't human.
It was basically some sort of concoction of a botched, you know, it was basically the makings of a supervillain, really. Mm. You know, botched. What?
Plastic surgery man, woman.
Yeah.
I shall take over the world with botched surgery.
One thing I find funny, something George Galloway said, is he's a woman, but he wants to be a man. And then it's this whole funny thing of Chantel saying, so, are you a man or a woman? Or do you think of yourself as a woman or a man? it's all these awkward questions.
God. It's the questions you want to ask him, but you don't have the balls to, and she did, so.
Literally.
Yeah. Ditzy blonde.
Yeah.
You know, with him, you know, I might end up being, I might not be saying, so you're a bloke. So why the hell do you have lips the size of a baboon's ass on your face?
who knows?
This has suddenly just turned into a let's bash Pete Burns session.
I enjoyed him as a housemate only because he had this attitude of, I'm bored, I'm going to pick a fight.
Yeah. I mean, the fight, the just pure boredom fight with Tracy Bingham was fantastic.
Which we'll get to later, Joe.
I know.
One thing we're going to be talking about, though, we're going to be moving on to the nominations. Nominees that week are Dennis, Pete, as mentioned again, and Faria Alarm. And after being nominated, Faria makes a comment which caused a lot of controversy when it was said. Maybe doesn't have, I'd argue it still has some sort of resonance now. She makes the argument that the British public wouldn't allow a black, someone of her race to win Big Brother. And this caused a lot of controversy within the fan base. Got into the national newspapers. What was your opinion about it? Because yes, Brian Bello won Big Brother 8, but we still haven't seen a black female really be in strong contention to win the show. Do you think that what a lot of Faria says resonates now?
I just think it's dumb luck that no one of that you know stature has won yet. It's, you know, it's all out of, you know, the public opinion. And, you know, it's a big gamble if you want to go in Big Brother and win. You know, it's, again, it's like between 11 and 16 or 24 people and you are only one person. So you either win it or you don't.
But the thing is, though, you make the argument, though, that because of the people who production casts, that they haven't allowed for there to be a black female which has proven successful. Because I'm looking through the list there and I'm thinking, the only person, the only black female who made the later stages as a realistic contender to win was Gina.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm. And I mean, that's a really hard thing to say. Because, like, do you think there was a resonance to what Faria said? Do you think a black woman can win a show like this?
The immediate reaction, of course, was the, oh God, don't be so stupid, pulling the race car, but maybe she has a valid point somewhere along the line, but you know, it's a deeper topic than this reality show has time to go into, really.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, change.
Yeah. If they can get a black president, we can get a black female winner with Big Brother. But we're going to move on, though, and we are going to be talking about that lady in question because, as mentioned, Faria is the one who ends up getting evicted.
Pretty much. I mean, of course, you could say, like, oh, yeah, that's proof she was right. But I think it was pretty much backlash from people from her pulling the race card, really.
Yeah.
You know, I'd argue as well that Faria, in some ways, was, we've seen this sort of famous for being famous, famous by association culture on Celebrity Big Brother. So we saw Katia get on there by sleeping with Ronnie Wood, and many examples like that. For me, you could argue was the first.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a bit awkward at the start of this series between Faria and Geordie, because Geordie disagreed with her celebrity status. I'm doing air quotes here, by the way. Because she's not really a celebrity, she just...
And this red. Comes from Jodie Marsh.
We're talking... I think I smell a cat fight. You know, you don't see it, but, you know, the reason why then she got voted out was because of the fact that Kate Moss just kept on ringing every single time just to get a go at her.
Hang on, Kate Moss?
Kate... But, oh, shit.
Kate Price.
You got the wrong supermodel, Paul.
Bugger.
I don't know about you. I was a little bit disappointed with Faria, I followed football at that point. I knew about her through the whole Sven Goran Eriksson affair, and I was expecting someone who was a bit more notorious, a bit more scandalous. And I didn't ever really got that. What we just had was just a dull woman in a show of eccentrics, and I think that showed. And again, we have the choice between potentially losing. Potentially losing Pete Burns or Dennis Rodman, the right choice was made by the public.
Yeah, I mean, she was very dull, very boring.
Any other opinions, Carl?
No, definitely right person went.
Yeah, she's definitely one of the more obscure celebrity housemates that there's been. I don't think anybody can really remember much about Faria.
I don't even know what she actually was famous for.
She's and famous. Honestly, I cannot. If you say a name, I cannot get an image of her in my mind.
Oh, there's the image of Sven Goran Eriksson. Oh, so, yeah. There we go.
Yeah.
Sven Goran Eriksson and Pete Burns. That's the reaction I want.
Yeah. We're keeping count of the amount of times you say Pete Burns in this podcast. Actually, to be fair, Joe's been quite good so far.
Yeah, been good.
I've been a good boy.
Yeah. But we are going to talk about Pete next, because we're going to be talking about something that Joe touched on there.
His
boredom-fueled attack on Tracy Bingham.
I love it. I just think Pete's brilliant that he can just, out of boredom, create an argument or do some kind of rude gesture that'll start some kind of fight.
Yeah.
And don't get me wrong, I don't support malicious behaviour. I think he was a dick, and he is a dick. But he's an entertaining dick.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is the perfect Big Brother villain. You need someone who, yes, can be nasty, who can draw, like, walk that tightrope between being nasty but still being fun with it. And I think Pete did that brilliant because, yes, he said nasty stuff, but there was something about him which was so pantomime, you could never really hate him for it.
Pantomime.
He had a charisma about him.
Pantomime.
Yeah, he was like a pantomime villain. He really was.
You basically were basic... You were basically one black dress away from being Maleficent.
Oh, I think Paul's got that right. I think one of the things that made Pete work as villain was because he looked like a pantomime deer.
Yeah. Cruella de Vil. That's what he looked like.
Yes. With the fur coat, yeah.
And coming from the puppies. Pete, what are you talking about? I don't know.
Mind you, the thing that stands out for me about that whole attack on Tracy, first of all, Tracy, throughout the whole argument, you can tell Pete's really going at it, just out of boredom, just saying, I just couldn't slide everything off about you, I really can't stand you. And Tracy's just sitting there, just with this big smile on her face throughout, not getting upset at all. Yeah. And also, Pete used the language, because I don't think anybody had heard of the word repugnant before that, and now I use it in all media.
Yeah.
And then there was the whole imbecile one.
Yeah. I think everybody at that point in the house, he'd already said that he wanted to go. Everybody knew that's what his game was. He was trying to get voted out.
Yes, too bad it didn't work because he was so entertaining.
By saying language that is only the equivalent of Russell Brand's sort of language there. All we just need is one swine and we're basically good to go.
Yeah. I'm actually surprised you're so supportive of Pete, because he's not the sort of character I expect you to like.
What do you mean? I like Pete. I think he's a character. I like him as a character.
Well, I certainly do as well.
I find him repugnant as a person, but, oh, I've used the word, yay! But, yay, yeah, I I think he, as a character, as a panto villain, dame, whatever the hell you want to call it, he was brilliant.
Yeah, I can't agree more. We're going to stick on the Pete theme, though. I'm going to talk about something which also caused a lot of controversy, and that's the gorilla court.
Yes, I love this.
Would you like to take this one forward, then, Joe? Explain to our audience what this was about.
Well, what it was towards the start of the show, actually, in the first week, Pete always wore a coat made of Columbus monkey fur. But Pete didn't know that it was this monkey, so he thought, and he was told it was gorilla. So he goes around saying, oh, this is gorilla fur. And obviously, it caused controversy.
Fuck like bloody Cruella de Vil. He is Cruella de fucking de Vil.
Yeah, so the audience phone the police, and the housemates aren't happy, and it gets taken off him, to which Pete has a total meltdown and goes in completely insane.
Doesn't he say something like, my coat's been arrested? The thing that really stands out about me, though, was that one of the things that it really highlights just how big Big Brother was at that point, because, Pete's gorilla coat was really an irrelevant issue throughout the course of the whole season. But the issue of gorilla fur and animal fur in general, it got raised in the House of Commons. There were people arguing about it online. It really helped to raise up that issue. And you can't imagine anything like that happening on Big Brother these days.
No, not at all.
I mean, what was the last big controversy on Big Brother? I remember the soap, I think, or something like that.
I'm trying to think, like, in terms of, like, getting worldwide notoriety. You'd argue Jane the Freezer?
Yeah.
But yeah, it really showed how big the show was, that something so irrelevant was getting airtime. Did you have an opinion on the whole gorilla fur thing, Carl?
No. It was just Pete having another thing that would be there just to rile people up. I guarantee that it probably was fake and he just said it was real just to piss people off.
Yeah. I would have loved it if he had gone the full-on Cruella de Vil and actually just come in like this, like...
Gorilla coat, puppy slippers, kitten mittens, a hat made out of a swan or something like that.
Yeah.
You've just reminded me, Paul, that even... sweeter part of that was the punishment Pete got for it.
Which was
he had to dress like a gorilla and walk around the house in a gorilla suit.
Oh, boy.
When Paul was just going on there about all the stuff that Pete would be wearing, I was just imagining Mr. Burns singing See My Chest.
Mr. Pete Burns.
But yeah, we'll move on from Pete's gorilla court. And we're going to go to the next eviction. Now, this one was interesting because it was fueled by Preston and George's punishment for discussing nominations. And as a punishment, they had to choose three people to be nominated. Now, I never understand why production chooses to punish people in this way. They said, you've been bad, so we're going to let you control the entire nominations.
Yes, because that doesn't go fucking wrong now, does it?
Well, it's going to fuel hate, isn't it, for them people?
It was more so a case of, I think if you look at it from a an international Big Brother standpoint, they are being punished by being given the head of household.
It doesn't matter.
Okay.
Woo! You'd want someone like that if you're on the outs in the house, you'd want to be punished for discussing nominations so you can nominate everybody and get rid of someone you don't like, one of the favourites.
Yeah.
Just never understood that one, and. There were strange choices as well, because the first people at that point that came to mind, if I was going to nominate in that house, Ruler, Tracy and Maggot wouldn't be the first three I'd think of.
No.
I think it's just who they could agree on, to be honest.
And of course, from those three, we end up losing Ruler, which I always thought was a strange one, because I never looked at that group and thought to myself, Ruler's someone I really passionately want to get rid of. I can imagine the voting being quite low on that one.
Yeah, I mean, she got 50% of the vote, so...
I guess the George Galloway thing, I guess. Who knows?
Yeah. Probably. Yeah. What did you make of Ruler as a person, though? Because she was pleasant enough.
Yeah, she was nice. I liked her.
Yeah, she liked a little bit of, you know, a little bit of Galloway play here and there. Like the Galloway here and there and everywhere.
It's quite sad though that all the Ruler's entire time in the house is summed up by just being there with George Galloway during his cat impression.
Mm. Yeah.
Is there anything else that we can bring up about Ruler as a housemaid? Because
she was fun. She was nice enough.
I liked, you know, she was very theatrical about everything.
Yeah. But I think that's really it. And I think one of the things that made this series so good, in my opinion, was that the lesser characters did go first.
Yeah.
In my opinion. Because we lost Faria, we lost Ruler, but they weren't big personalities, were they?
No.
We'll move on, though. I'm sorry, Ruler. I know Ruler might have some fans on the internet, but honestly, we just can't really think of anything else to say about it.
But really, the Ruler is dead.
We're going to move on, though. I'm going to go to something which is a little bit more talked about, however, which is the Emotions Through Dance Task. Well, basically, the house was split into four pairs of two, 8 housemates left, of course, and they were all asked to choose a emotion, which they had to represent through a type of dance. So, of course, Chantel and Barrymore were paired up. I think that was anger through Irish dancing, which was very funny. And I think Dennis did something which was, I think, fear through ballet or something like that.
And Pete Baird basically doing.
The one which everybody remembers is, and I love how accurate and how word for word this was, despair when a puppy won't come back to you when called through the form of robotics. And that was Pete and George's.
Okay, yeah.
That was actually pretty intricate.
They tried.
Irish dancing and then fucking despair when a puppy doesn't come to you through robotics.
Yeah.
And it leads, of course, to Galloway's robot dance. Now, everybody remembers the cat impression in terms of the oh my god, George Galloway story of Big Brother Celebrity 4. Nobody ever seems to remember this, but this was just as cringeworthy.
Yeah, it was something, but like we said, he went all in on the tasks. That's what he was asked to do, so he did.
I love the shot of absolute horror from the rest of the housemates to watch it, because like, the audience obviously would be feeling that same way, but I love that cut to Mike, where he's just like, oh my god.
You didn't have to try this hard, George.
It's like watching, you know, that overly enthusiastic, you know, contested on something really, really stupid, like it's a knockout. I'm ready to do this! I'm ready to do this! You're dressed up like...
Oh, 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 oh.
No. I'm too enthusiastic for that.
Jim will fix it and now it's a knockout.
Yeah,
yeah, we're going down dodgy lines here.
Not the old one, the other one. The
yeah, Chegwin.
There we go.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Galloway just taking it far too seriously for me. I love little aspects of it. I love the fact that like he was whistling to try and say the wrong. And this is one right at the end. He like slaps his forehead. He's just like, oh no, the puppy still won't come back. Yeah. Mind you, it did give us Kraftwerk. It did. Kraftwerk was played at the house, and for that, I will forgive them.
Yeah, not bad. Not bad.
A very funny task, though. And we move on to the last shopping task, which leads to one of the great celebrity arguments, which is the banking task. Would you like to take this one away for us, Carl?
Okay, remind me. It's been a while since I've seen this one.
Yeah, well, the house hits basically split into... it's basically a banking management task, where basically Chantal and Preston are set up as banking executives.
Oh, and they've got their little room and where they've got the fire and the... Yeah. And this wasn't this the catalyst towards the whole George Michael argument?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. So, yeah, basically, they didn't agree with the decisions. George became more and more of a villain. That Michael kind of stood up against him. Throughout the entire of the show, Michael had been kind of, George has been like, Michael, I want him to win. I want him to win. And then all of a sudden they turned against each other, and I don't really remember why, but they did. And then George started having a go at him full on, and Michael seems like much of a hero the way he stood up against him. And George came out of that line, pour me another, which, you know, as Pete said, is a saying, but everybody else took it literally as if he was taking a piss out of his alcoholism. Yes. And that was what got George the huge booze and got kicked out of the house.
Well, I took it as a stab at Michael's alcoholism.
Yeah, it's what made George the villain of the series, and it what made Michael pretty much second place.
I think so, yeah. I think so as well. You actually made me onto the point of, do you think this helped Barrymore in the long run? Because
absolutely. Before this, he'd been, you know, he was a dick to Jodie earlier on, then he was just kind of nothing. This was the moment where it was like, yes, Michael, screw him. You know, he's standing up against this guy who was taking the piss out of his past. And, yeah.
Actually, one thing I do remember now, remembering the series, is Michael cried a lot.
Yes. But again, I think that goes to the whole fragile state that Michael was in as a contestant, because this was someone who, in my opinion, just was overwhelmed by the whole experience, the fact he was there and the reasons why he was there. I think
that And I think also this was the fact that he had cried a bit so weak throughout, the fact that he was so strong and so sort of like, you know what, George, just get lost. And that was the moment where people were like, yes, he's built himself back up. He has been on a journey, to use a cliche. And that's, I get what people liked him so much enough to vote for him. So.
We're going into Charlie Sheen territory right now, so, you know.
Yeah.
It was on his best. Yeah.
The one thing that stands out for me from that argument as well, I know everyone remembers Michael and Barrymore. I remember Preston really, he was very pro-Michael about all that. He was the one who brought up the whole connection of Barrymore's alcoholism. He was like, that's low. And then there was Dennis Rodman, because like, it almost like with Dennis Rodman, he'd almost say nothing for the entirety of the series. And then suddenly he would just start screaming at everybody.
Yeah.
And that was one of those situations, it's just like out of nowhere, he's Dennis defending George and kicking off big time.
Oh, what? And thus one of the many reasons why Dennis Rodman can kick ass.
Yeah.
Aww.
Well, we already knew he was a prick, so.
Yeah.
There we go.
And of course, we'd see that in later shows. He's pretty much like a Stephen Baldwin. He's done every single reality show on the circuit by now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And we're actually going to come on to Dennis Rodman, because we've got a double eviction, which is Chantel versus Dennis versus George for that week. And has there ever been any more of an obvious double eviction than this? Chantel, your hero of the series, who's almost inevitably going to win, versus Dennis Rodman, who's just kicked off at the new victim, Michael Barrymore, and George Galloway.
Yeah.
I mean, this must be the most blatant result ever.
Yeah.
Basically, in the words, if I'm going down, you're coming down with me, asshole.
Yeah. But of course, we're going to be talking to the first person of those two who got evicted, and that is George. Now, we talked about the concept of George being in there and whether it was right or wrong. In my opinion, he fully justified being there. He was a great housemate.
He was brilliant.
He could have been a boring politician and pretended to be all nice throughout the entire show and basically used it as a campaign for votes, which I'm sure is what he thought he was doing. But instead he was himself, rightly or wrongly, but we liked him. And towards the end, I know a lot of people didn't. But at the end of the day, he provided a hell of a lot of entertainment to one of the biggest characters in there. And it may have ruined his political career, but it made good entertainment dating television for us.
Yeah.
More damage to his political career than the Nick Griffin going on a cooking show.
Yeah, I think he could have gone into the House of Parliament and said that 9/11 was an inside job, and I think he probably would have done less damage than going on this show.
To be fair to George, though, since then he has sort of laughed it off a little bit, because I mean, I don't agree with the man politically. I don't agree with all of his opinions. He is a big charismatic personality. I remember he had a talk show on TalkSport, like a political talk show, and he actually used Top Cat as his theme tune.
Again, people overreacted to things on this show, and that's Big Brother, isn't it? That's the celebrity culture.
Yeah.
One thing he has done, though, is he's set such a high pedestal for politicians on reality television that everybody else is going to be disappointed. Because I remember when we talked about Tommy Sheridan in Celebrity 6, everybody expected him to be another George Galloway, and were very underwhelmed when he didn't live up to that.
Because they learned, and I think he was the main person who, not only for politicians, but for celebrities in general, either made sure they kept away from this show, more of the high-profile guys stayed away from the show from this point onwards, and especially with what happened the next year, it was kind of a 1-2 punch, the George Galloway, then the Shilpa Shetty thing, it was kind of to say to celebrities, stay away from this show, it will do nothing but harm to your career, and, and really the same thing for politicians even more so.
Yeah.
Except, unless, of course, you're Dennis Rodman. You've got North Korea to help you out there.
And thank you for bringing up Dennis Rodman, because he leaves shortly afterwards. And this is where we talk about Dennis as the housemate, because I was a little bit disappointed with him.
Yeah.
Well, no, I'd heard so much notoriety about him as a celebrity. I knew about the whole Carmen Electra thing. I knew about his cross-dressing. And
God.
What?
Don't remind me of that.
Yeah. And most beautiful bride I ever saw. we just got a bit of a mystery, because in some ways he was sort of like the Evander Holyfield of his day.
Yeah, he went to there. Everybody thought he was going to be this big controversial character, and said he just kind of hung back and wasn't really involved until the end. And when he did get involved, he got kicked out for it. So
yeah. So it was kind of his, you know, his fault for, you know, not being more of a character earlier on.
Well, I think that the fact that he didn't, you know, what's the word, pipe up, the fact that he didn't pipe up earlier on kept him in as long as he did. Because as soon as he showed his real personality, he would have been kicked out for it.
Yes. So,
yeah.
One thing you will say about Dennis in those early stages, though, did you have any opinions on the relationship between him and Tracy? Because they obviously knew each other from before then, because I thought it was Tracy being a new Carmen Electra, who knew Dennis Rodman. And I especially remember when they came in, when Dennis came into the house, Tracy runs up to me and he's just like, no, not you, not you.
I'm out. Screw this. Brit, you're on your own. Have you a cup of tea? I'm out.
Anybody else?
Well, yeah, I knew they knew each other, but that's, you know, that's as far as I got with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll move on from Dennis then. And really,
finale.
You send your?
It's finale night.
Finale night, yes. Now this is the first time we got a 6-person finale, and because most of the time it's just been 4 or 3 up till then. Now it's 6. And that sort of set an awful precedent, because now 6 is usually the norm for most evictions. Did you enjoy that? Did you like the idea of a 6-person finale?
I think it was good. It was a good, you know, change up from having 3 or 4.
What about you, Carl?
Yeah, it was something that's I wish they'd do more of, to be honest.
Personally, I've always been old school. I think 4 in the finale's right for me.
It depends how much time they've got.
Yeah. What about you? Yeah. What about you, Paul?
I was gonna say. It felt a little bit more tense, a little bit more, you know, a little bit more real. If there were more than four people in there. I mean, you know, when you did well, the last night when Johnny and all them from a couple of another big
series three.
When they went in there, right, you could tell that they were all, you know, all huddled together. You know, they've been through a lot and all that. With this, it was just basically, oh, all right, well, see.
Yeah, I don't think the tension was there, because, and as well, especially with the result, because we knew Chantal was going to win. We knew Tracy was going to be 6th. We knew Pete was going to be 5th. Your only real tension was who's going to finish top between Michael, Preston and Maggot. That was the only real tension.
Yeah, sorry, I was distracted when you spoke about it before. I thought you meant it the other way around. I thought you meant that there was less people. Yeah, I do agree there should be less people in the finale. Yeah. It depends how much time they've got, but at the same time, the fact it means there's longer for the interviews. It means that we can focus on these people. And it also gives this house, for the last day, it gives this house this sort of like loneliness, of sort of like we're the only ones left, kind of.
And it makes them realise just how big the financial is when the house is so sparse.
Yeah. And also, you know, the impact of the finale night. I mean, over the years, you get bloody masses of fans going in. Then you get some fans, and then to this day, you just get small huddle of fans, and what I would like to call the wet firework effect.
Yeah, whereas back then it was, you know, the finale, they'd open it up, there'd be so many more people there, there'd be these huge fireworks display. It felt like an event.
And they, and they direct the stage as well. They'd actually, yeah. That was the only time they actually do a stage in front of the live eviction crowd. Before then, it would used to be just the studio.
Yeah.
But we're going to talk about the first victim of finale night, and as I mentioned, no surprise, Tracy Bingham. Now, I've always been of the belief that had this have been a later series, any other series, Tracy, in my opinion, could have done well. She had that, an innocence about her, she was likeable, she was wide-eyed, there was a novelty of her being American, she was gorgeous, and yet, in this one, she's a bit part player.
She was there. She had provided some entertainment with some arguments, but she was just kind of there.
She was a air horn siege filler. You know, the person who just went every five minutes.
But she was pleasant though. She was likable with though. But I think as well she was quite a victim of the edit, because there was this real relationship between her and Maggot. They would always spend these late night chats just talking between each other. And I know digital spies sometimes get it wrong, but they really loved the Maggot and Tracy live feed conversations, and he never made the highlight show.
Yeah.
Because she was just irrelevant to the storyline of the series, because the storyline of the series was Barry Moore's.
But that was the advantage of live feed back then, isn't it? That you could have this more of you on people if you wanted to.
Yeah. And what's happened is, since they've axed the live feed, they've got more control over the story. They can gear the show in a direction much more easily.
And that's why people are more cynical to the edit these days.
Yes, certainly. But I like Tracy. I mean, she wasn't exciting, and she'll never be an all-star by any means. But she was pleasant. I probably would have hated her if she'd won. But for a sixth-place field filler in a finale, she was nice enough.
I mean, she was the only, you know, well, she was the... or the American to be in the finale, you know, with Dennis just missing it.
Yes, the only American in this series.
Mm.
We move on, though, and we're going to move on to someone who we all enjoyed in the show, Pete Burns.
Oh, God.
Take this one away, Paul.
Right. Pete. All right, the first thing I would like to say, he was brilliant as a villain. Unfortunately, it was a little bit too much when you start to think that it's not, he's not acting like Cruella de Vil. She is Cruella de Vil. There's not a lot of people who can actually do that, who can actually mid-sentence. So bear with me. But yeah, with Pete Burns, you can actually see he's an entertaining character, but unfortunately has a bit of a vile sort of undertaste to it. So yeah.
It's kind of become this thing of, we know his game now. It was entertaining for a series, but I don't want to see him on Bit on the Side or whatever, because you know that he hasn't got interest in the show and he's just there to stir stuff up and say horrible words.
He admits it. He admits he just goes on Bit on the Side to wind people up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that's just so Pete, though, in my opinion.
Yeah. I enjoyed him in this show, but he was definitely, you know, a villain, let's put it that way. You wouldn't want to live with the guy.
Any great Pete moments that come to mind for you?
Me?
In general.
For me, I think again, just the arguments, the drama, and yeah, that's what he provided.
Did you say something? Hello.
Hello, Jeter.
Hello, I've broke up. I can hear you. What did you say? Sorry.
Do you have any favorite Pete moments, Joe?
Just the whole debacle, the, you know, the argument, the fight, the fellatio with flowers.
It was
brilliant. A villain.
I mean, if there was a celebrity big, if there was an ultimate celebrity Big Brother, Pete would have to be on there.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking about saying that he was one of the people who was on the main shortlist to be on Ultimate Big Brother, but he turned it down.
Probably. Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah. But real great entertainment. I've always been supportive of Peter's outfit, and I know he's quite divisive, and I understand some of the reasons why people don't like him, but he was just pantomime fun and great for it, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Now, as I mentioned before, second through the fourth was where we got interesting. And I don't know about you, I was taken a bit surprised by the fact that Preston finished fourth. I expected it to be a Preston and Chantel finale.
Yeah, I was really shocked when Micah beat Preston.
What about you, Paul?
Actually, it gives more of a bit of a spice because of the fact that Preston didn't win. Well, he didn't come second. So bringing sort of a gap between the couple, sort of thing.
I mean, I do think Micah had more personality than you know, Preston.
Oh, yeah. But I part of me always thought the Chantel connection would help Preston. Like, Preston would leech off her popularity and end up benefiting himself, and that didn't seem to be the case, which surprised me.
Yeah, I think a lot of people saw through the relationship.
Do you have an opinion about Preston, Carl?
He was a nice enough guy, and he had his moments of piping up, and he joined in with things, and he did have a storyline, but... yeah, I'm glad it wasn't him who won just because of his celebrity status. Let's put it that way.
And yet you're okay with Chantel, the non-celebrity, winning?
Yes, because I think she provided more.
Okay.
You can make the argument, though, of all the housemates in the series, especially in the series, I don't know if it's about all time, he was one of the biggest beneficiaries of being on Celebrity Big Brother. I mean, the Ordinary Boys re-released Boys Will Be Boys, he got to the top 10, he got a nice... gold certified album out of it.
Yeah, if you're a hero on the show, you can, it's same as I'm a Celebrity, you can get a revival out of your career, at least, especially at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, he got a revival out of his, you know, career from this.
I believe You Spin Me Round got re-released.
Mm. Yeah, it was number 5 in the charts.
Hey, it's a decent pop song.
Yeah, it's good, but, why try and relive something that was 20 years ago?
Because that's all he's got.
And also, on a very disturbing note, that song is now linked to the now notorious meatspin.com. Don't, for the love of God, Google it!
Yeah.
So Preston goes out fourth, and we come to the third placer, which is Maggot. Now, Maggot, for me, is one of the best examples of... If you ever study Edgic, if you ever on Survivor Sucks and look at Edgic, Maggot is the perfect UTRP male. He's likable, he stays under the radar, he's likable, he's pleasant, very self-depreciating, which I think appealed to a lot of people. But people like that shouldn't win. And I probably like Maggot a lot more because he didn't win. If he'd won, I'd compare him like to the likes of Sam. Sam for me is another UTRP male, but the difference is whilst Maggot was self-depreciating and likable with it, Sam was just a sympathy role winner. So I like Maggot for the role that he played in the house. He was pleasant enough. And yeah, I thought he was decent, but I didn't want him to do any better than third.
No, same, yeah, pretty much.
Well, he's riding on the success of Golden Looking Chain.
In inverted commas, success.
Yeah. Yeah, but, again, yeah, most people, most of the type of people that Maggot are basically likable, chilled out sort of people.
And that appealed to a lot of people, and I never got the impression with Maggot that he was arrogant with his celebrity status.
Yeah, and plus the fact he's Welsh. We Welsh people, we don't say, oh, I'm famous, I'm famous, aren't I?
What about you, George? Do you have any? Do you have any opinions on Maggot?
I agree totally. He was a nice fella, And looking at the statistics here and the nominations table, he only received one nomination throughout the whole game.
Oh.
So, that's a really good record. I think the only person that equaled that was Pete Bennett.
I believe the twins from Big Brother 8 never received a single nomination.
The girl twins or the...
The girl twins.
Oh. Well, no.
Barbies.
Yeah. And of course, if you remember, Maggot's one nomination came on the week when it was just Preston and George nominated together.
Yeah.
So I think that's really telling of us how likeable the guy he was. But as I mentioned before, someone that... He didn't do enough to justify winning.
Yeah, I totally agree.
Yeah. But we come to the final two, which is Chantel and Barrymore. we've got the two big storylines of the series, and I don't like manipulations of the producers to try and make storylines happen. When it comes naturally, I do like it, and we have the two big storylines of the series in the final two together, which in my opinion is the way it should have been. And it was actually surprisingly close between the two. I mean, Chantel wins, but it's only 56% of the votes. I expected it to be a lot bigger of a win.
Yeah. I mean, I think the thing with Chantel and Michael was throughout the whole series, they had kind of like a father-daughter relationship. You know, every time Michael cried, it was always Chantel who was there to wipe his tears. And, you know, Michael was like a father to her.
I think Chantel was pretty much was the daughter of a lot of people in the house. And I think that's why they were so protective of her about Geordie, because they saw Geordie as the bad influence towards the sweet, innocent girl.
Yeah.
But we're going to talk about Barry more, because, I mean, we touched on it a lot of the times beforehand, but what did you make of him as a character? Because he's probably one of the more complex Big Brother housemates.
Yeah, he was complex and he was utterly mad.
Well, he wasn't mad. He was just really just sick to death of almost everything. And
he got stressed out emotionally in there.
Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah.
What about you, Carl? Michael Barrymore, Big Brother housemate.
Yeah, for me, I think that he was definitely the one that went on the journey, as to use a cliche. He was the guy who went to there with all this bad press, with all this controversy, and came out pretty likable. And it was sort of, you almost had this feeling that he was going to reemerge from this, but that never happened.
Why do you think that didn't happen, though? Because you'd expect, as you mentioned, with the journey, in inverted commas, the fact that he did, by the end of the series, redeem himself to being quite a likeable bloke. Got cheers on the launch night and the finale night. And yet, there was no comeback that a lot of people expected.
Probably because of the ongoing legal stuff.
And Barrymore just doesn't want to get back in the limelight.
I think he did. He wouldn't go on the show if he didn't.
Well, yeah, but, you know, he did. I mean, now he doesn't. He wants to, you know, like, just stay a little bit low until, you know, he gets a game show sort of appeal, minus Hitler jokes. So.
Yeah. But I was okay with Michael as a person. If you took a step backwards and saw his journey in the same way you would a scripted drama, you'd appreciate the character. I wasn't too keen on the person because at times I think he came across as a bit desperate and a bit warpy. But as I said, if you took a step backwards, I appreciated him a lot more. But now we come to our winner, which is Chantel.
The non-celebrity winner.
The non-celebrity celebrity winner, although we pushed that close with Paddy Doherty.
Or as we all like to call him, that gypsy who basically gives gypsies a bad name.
Who calls everyone woman.
Yeah. And I don't know about you. I don't know about you because I like Chantel. I like Chantel as a person, but I don't know about you. I think she hasn't aged well as a winner. I think when people saw the series, they thought, "Oh, Chantel was amazing. I think she's one of the best winners ever. She was likable. She was funny." But you look sit back now, she wasn't really that entertaining. She had the storyline with Preston. She had the storyline of being on Celebrity. And in my opinion, that was really it. I think the audience in general want a bit more complexity in the winners. And Chantel never really got that. In the same way that I think Pete's win has become tainted by being the chosen one, the obvious winner. I think the same thing happened to Chantel.
Yeah, I see where you're coming from there. It's kind of like, it's tainted because she was a winner so early on.
Do you feel that way, Carl?
If it was going to be one of the heroes, and, you know, obviously the way that the general public are going to see, I don't think, you know, Pete or any of those was ever going to win. If it was going to be one of the more characters, I would rather it been her because she had to work for it, because of the early stuff. Whereas I think that others kind of coasted by and didn't add as much as she did. So, yes, yeah, did she make the show? No. But if it had to be one of the people, one of the nice people, definitely.
Do you think the interpretation of Chantel as a winner is still good these days?
I don't know. I think that people... She's still in the public eye, so...
Is she out there for quite
Well, it turns to brag mags anyway.
Mind you, though, it's good to know that, you know, if you're a nice person, you still can win. But unfortunately, you know, she didn't bring anything to the table. Come to think of it, the only thing she could probably bring to the table is, you know, a paperclip or something like that. While everyone else is bringing big, massive, you know, things onto the table. But still, Chantel, paperclip, there we go.
It's Winford.
And she won.
Well, we come to the series assessment, which is where we talk about the series in general. Did you enjoy Celebrity 4, lads?
Yes, I loved it.
Probably the best one for me, just because, and I'll tell you why, because I never really was a fan of the Celebrity ones. I mean, they were always entertaining in a different way, but I never knew most of celebrities, so the celebrity factor never really affected me. So in terms of just a good series, it, like almost a miniature version of the main series, it was very, very good.
I've got it as my top celebrity series. It's 4, then 13, the Jim Davidson series, and then 9, Carissa, Christina, Michael Madsen, etc.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was such a good series, and I know the celebrity version's taken over as being the dominant one, and you could argue this was the reason for it, but this was great fun, this series, and I really appreciated Fallout.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and that's all that we can really say about Celebrity 4. We've had a fantastic time talking about this series. I hope you've enjoyed listening to it at home. This has been Carl Bainbridge. That's been Carl Dunn.
See you later, guys.
That's been Joseph Tilly.
Goodbye.
That's been Paul Barron.
And now for some outro music. I've got to have my way now.